Yeah, thanks a lot for the introduction. And yeah, my topic today is about compute shaders. So first, I will just explain what compute shaders are, what makes them different from other shader types. And then I will talk about how shaders are actually executed on the GPU, what is happening on the hardware side. And then I go a level deeper on the programming, how code is executed on the GPU, how the instructions get like translated so that the GPU can actually execute them. And at the end, we will look at a concrete example, is downsampling, how you can do downsampling using compute. Okay, so but what are compute shaders actually? And what makes them different from other shader stages? If you've done some graphics programming before, you probably know the graphics pipeline. So usually you have some models, they are made of a bunch of vertices, so they get into the GPU, then they get processed, the vertices get invoked using the vertex shader, then you can have some tessellation if you want, or geometry shader is up to you, then the rasterizer is doing its stuff so that you get the actual pixels, and then we have the pixel shader, and at the end we have the render target, so your output. But what about compute shaders? So you may have realized that compute shaders are just not part of the logical graphics pipeline. So how, what to do this is? So to understand this, first I want to still talk about the graphics pipeline and what's happening on the hardware side. So what's happening if you have a draw command? So you call draw from your API side, and what's happening? So first, the command processor kicks in. The command processor is just processing all the commands which you send to the GPU and is deciding what to do next. So in case of draw command, the command processor is routing the work to the graphics processor. And the graphics processor is the hardware unit where we will typically find such stuff as the input assembler. So on the logical side, the input assembler, you can translate it on the hardware side to be placed at the graphics processor unit. Then we have the vertices. The compute unit is the part of the hardware which is doing the shader work. So the actual computing stuff is all performed here on the compute units. So the vertex shaders are processed by the compute units. Then it goes to the rasterizer. The pixels going back to the compute units, which are doing the pixel shaders stuff. And then at the end, it goes to the render backend, and you have your render target output. But what happens now if we have dispatch call? So in a dispatch, again, the command processor takes over because we still kind of need to decide what to do in the GPU, right? So command processor kicks in and sees, oh, it's a dispatch command. So in case of dispatch command, we don't need a graphics processor because it's not a graphics command. So it gets directly routed to the compute units. And the compute units are doing their compute shader work. And that's basically it. So the input and output is provided via resources and constants for input, and output are writable resources, so UIVs, also unordered access views. And yeah, so you see, if you use compute shaders, you have less hardware units which are actually activated and needed. And this also translates directly on the API level when you create the pipelines. So if you create the compute shader pipeline, you just need to provide information about the compute shader stage. But if you create the graphics pipeline, you also need to provide information about the vertex shader stage and any other stage you want to bind to the pipeline. And then, of course, information about the input assembler, if you have tessellation on, about tessellation, about the rasterizer, and so on. So what to take away from this short section is that if you use compute shaders, you have less hardware overhead introduced than if you use compared to other shader stages. So next, about execution model. So how are shaders actually executed on the GPU? To understand this, it's important to understand how GPUs are designed. And GPUs are designed to process a massive amount of data in parallel. So typical use cases for GPU work are that you have the same program to run on many vertices and many, many pixels. So usually you have one shader for millions of pixels. In case of compute shaders, we call the singles, like the smallest work item, a thread. So don't confuse it with threads from the CPU side. You may know here it's just the smallest work item. So vertex shader, the smallest work item is the vertex. For pixel shader, the smallest work item is the pixel. And for compute shaders, we call the smallest work item a thread. So how is this now realized, this parallelism on the hardware side? Well, there are two concepts. First, we have SIMD units. So SIMD is for single instruction multiple data. And then we have like a bunch of SIMD units grouped on a compute unit. And then we have many compute units on the compute shader itself, on the graphics card itself. So compute unit. I talked about it a bit before, but what are compute units in detail? To understand this, I took a specific example here. So this is a compute unit in case of GCN architecture. If you take a different GPU architecture, it will look different in detail, but the general concepts will be the same. So you can directly map like the concepts to other GPU architectures. So in case of GCN, we have 4 SIMD units per compute unit. And each SIMD unit is 16 wide. Here, as you see them. And then we have a bunch of caches, registers, and all those kind of things. So if you look back on the whole GPU, we have several compute units. And the typical number is, for example, for the Vega 64, we have 64 compute units. Right. So this is on the hardware side. So, but now, how is the work actually distributed on the SIMDs? So we could basically schedule each thread one by one to the SIMD units. But it does not sound really efficient, right? Because if we have millions of threads, and if you schedule each one by one to the SIMD units, well, that's quite a bit of overhead. No, actually, there's a hierarchy of work items, which kind of defines how the work is distributed to the SIMDs. So the top level is, if you have the dispatch call, you provide like 3 parameters. And this actually defines the number of thread groups you invoke per dispatch call. Thread group is just a group of threads, obviously. So in this specific example, we have 24 threads. So 4 from the x-axis, 3 from the y-axis, and 2 from the z-axis. Just like a 3-dimensional grid. And then the thread group size is defined within the shader itself. So in case of HLSL, you use the numThread tag. In this example, one thread group has 64 threads. So if you look at the specific thread root, 1, 2, 0, you have like here those 64 threads. And so for one single thread, you can identify a specific kind of indices. So first, you can specify the index of the thread within the thread group, which is 5, 1, 0. You can specify the index of the group within the whole dispatch. That's 2, 1, 0. And you also can specify the index of the thread within the whole dispatch. This 21, 3, 0. And here, SV group index is just the index of the thread within the thread group, but in 1D. So in this case, it would be 13. So, but now we have this hierarchy. And now, how is the work actually scheduled to the SIMDs, right? So back to the top level, we have the thread groups. And the thread groups get actually scheduled one by one to a compute unit. So thread group A gets scheduled to compute unit 1, thread group B gets scheduled to compute unit 2, and so on. And then we know a whole thread group is placed to one compute unit, and then the threads get scheduled to the SIMDs. But again, we don't want to schedule them one by one. We actually schedule them in groups to the single SIMD units. And the size of the groups can vary. In case of GCN, it's 64, we call it wavefront. If you have an NVIDIA card, it would be probably 32 and called warp. I will stick here with the term wavefront just to be in line because I took the example of GCN here. But just know that the size of the subgroups can vary. Right, and those wavefronts get now scheduled to available SIMD units. If you have noticed, the whole thread group here was 64 threads. So this means this whole thread group is just one wavefront. This means this one wavefront gets scheduled to a SIMD unit, and this also means the whole thread group gets scheduled to a SIMD unit. If the thread group now would have 128 threads, then you would have 2 wavefronts, and each wavefront gets scheduled to an available SIMD unit. So wavefront 1 gets scheduled to SIMD unit 1, and wavefront 2 gets scheduled to SIMD unit 2, depends how it's available from the workspace. And then here, maybe you have noticed that this line per SIMD, so wavefronts can be currently in flight. what does it mean? Well, if you schedule a wavefront to a SIMD unit, then it's doing the instructions, and then we hit, for example, memory instruction, which has high latency. So the SIMD unit could just like schedule the memory instruction, just sit and wait until it's finally completed. That doesn't sound that performant, right? So to hide this latency, we actually have several wavefronts concurrently in flight on the SIMD. So if one wavefront needs to wait for an operation to complete, the next wavefront can just take over and the instruction can be executed. So this means that we kind of want to have several wavefronts per SIMD, and the number of wavefronts we can have per SIMD depends on how many resources the compute shade actually needs. I will come back to this a bit later. So now we kind of figured out how the work is scheduled to the SIMD units. What can we conclude from this? Well, first we know that thread groups, if they need to communicate with each other, different compute units need to communicate with each other. Because we simply can't say if two thread groups are on the same compute unit or if they are on two different compute units. Most probably they will be on two different, but we simply can't say anything about this. So if they need to communicate with each other, they need to kind of like do this cross compute unit communication. How is this done? Well, there's the L2 cache. So it needs to go at least to the L2 cache, and it's not that performant. So this is why thread group communication should be kept to a minimum. It's just higher latency, and you should try to avoid it. But what about threads within a single thread group? Well, we know they're on the same compute unit, right? So if they want to communicate with each other, we have the L1 cache, we also have the registers, and we have this special memory called local data share. What is local data share? Well, local data share is a type of memory which is also used by other shader types. So for example, the pixel shader uses it for interpolance. But since it's already used by the pixel shader, you can't use it directly. So as a programmer, you have no way to exit the local data share because it's already used. But compute shaders, they don't need local data share, so it's basically free for us to use it if we want to use it. So if you want to use it in the shader code, you need to use the group shared storage class modifier, and then you can just write into it and read back from it from different threads within the same thread group. You just need to make sure that you synchronize. Because if one thread group writes into the local data share, another one wants to read from it, you need to be sure that the other thread group thread already has like completed its instruction. Yeah, and local data share is quite fast. It's actually even faster than L1 cache. So if you have memory data which is accessed several times within a thread group, you may think about using local data share. Right. So to sum this section up, thread group communication, which is cross-compute communication, is kind of slow. So try to keep it to a minimum. But inter-thread communication within a single thread group, that's quite fast. You even have local data share to help you. So this is kind of like special for compute shaders. What about waveforms? Remember, we have like thread groups and then even those subgroups, which get scheduled to the single SIMD units. Well, there are special instructions called waveform-wide instructions. I won't go too much into detail during this talk, but I want to mention it here, just that you know they exist. And in certain cases, you can use them to even speed your compute shader more. So, but let's go to programming and see how to actually code efficiently for compute shaders. And for that, let's look at a concrete example. So here we have a compute shader, and then we have the instruction float A equal index plus B. Index is here the index within the thread group in 1D. And then we have integer c equals group index dot x. This group index is the ID of the thread group. So what can we observe? Well, the value a is different per thread because it depends on the index of the thread. So obviously it's different per thread. So we need for each thread its own copy. But what about c? Well, c is dependent on the index of the thread group. So it means for all threads within this wavefront, which are obviously from the same thread group, they have the same value for C. So it's efficient enough to just store one copy of this variable to C. So, if you just need to store one copy, we call it a uniform variable, and it's stored in the Scala registers. If we need for each thread its own copy, it's called non-uniform variable, and we store it in the vector registers. So we need, it's per wavefront always, so we need 64 copies in case of VGPRs. So even though if we have like in total more memory for VGPRs, we can store less data than for the SGPRs because they are way bigger, 64 times the size, kind of. So this also means that you kind of should like be careful when you use VGPRs. I know it's not something you can directly influence as a programmer because the shader compiler does a lot of optimizations and usually it tries to minimize the VGPR users as much as possible anyway, but if you have the choice in using a non-uniform variable over a uniform variable, you should use the uniform variable because VGPRs are limited and if you use too many of them per wavefront, you reduce the maximum number of wavefronts you actually can have in flight at assembly units. And that's what I was talking about before. When you have several wavefronts concurrently on assembly units, you can hide latency. If you use too many VGPRs, you reduce the maximum number of wavefronts per assembly units, so the ability to hide latency gets just reduced. So just as a hint. So the next thing is, well, let's look at this again. So here, this is the non-uniform variable. So it's stored in the VGPRs. In IsoCore, it looks something like this. So the V stands for VGPR, then it's an addition, and it's a float type. And the register V0 gets added with the value of what's held in V1, and it gets stored in V2. So what, since it's a VGPR, we know we have 64 copies per thread because the whole wavefront is 64 threads, right? But what is if we have actually a thread group with size 4? Well, we still need to schedule a whole wavefront. So we still have 64 copies, but we just activate 4 of them. So 60 copies actually just inactivated, but they still need to run because we can't schedule less than 64 threads. So and to deactivate and activate threads, we have the execution mask. So if it's activated, we have a 1. If it's deactivated, we have a 0. So in this case, only the first 4 threads are activated. The others 1 are just inactivated. And anything that's like stored here, it's just not valid. And remember also that I said the assembly is actually 16 wide. Well, this simply means that each instruction gets executed 4 times with each 16 threads. And this is also true even if all 16 threads are deactivated. So this is why it kind of makes sense to choose a thread group of size a multiple of 64, because then you don't waste those like inactive threads which you need to run even though they don't do anything. Right, so execution mask, they're also used for branches. Because how are branches actually executed on the GPU? Well, let's look at the ISA code, which this kind of code actually produces. So in the beginning, the execution mask is saved. Then we perform the condition. We update execution mask. We check if one of the threads actually return true. If yes, then we need to go into block B. If not, we can take the short path and can go directly to C. And then, so if it's not, so if one at least one thread return true, we can go into block B. We need to go. Then it's computed, and then the execution mask gets inverted, then it goes into C, and then in the end to D. Let's look at this a bit closer and actually see what happens with the execution mask. So in the beginning of the branching block, we need to save the execution mask to actually like store the information about which threads were active and which not. So in this case, all threads were active. So it was just a waveform with 64 active threads. So we save this information. Then we do the condition test. And the result gets written in some register. this doesn't change the execution mask yet. We just evaluated the condition. And then we actually move the result of the condition test over to the execution mask, so we update the execution mask. So in this case, we see that some threads return true, other threads return false. So if we check if the execution mask is zero, it's obviously not true because some threads return true. This means we need to go into block B and need to compute the if part. This doesn't change the execution mask, obviously, again. So if we're done with the if part, we invert the execution mask. So now the threads which were inactivated, they get activated, and the other way around. And then we check again if the execution mask is zero. Of course, it's not in this case. So we also need to go into block C, and the else part gets executed. And then after that, we go into block D. We restore the initial state of the execution mask, which was this one on the top. And then we just proceed with the callbots and our comms after the branching block. So what can we conclude from this, how branches are actually executed? Well, as soon as one thread falls into a block, the block gets executed for the whole wavefront. So even if just one thread is activated, all other 63 threads, they still need to go through this block. So this means that you should try to avoid those divergent threads within a wavefront. So what you want to have is that all threads return true or all threads return false. How can you kind of achieve this? Well, So you don't want this, right? You want to take the shortcut. So how can you achieve this? Well, you can do scalar comparisons, because scalar comparison has just one copy, which is the same for all the threads within the wavefront. So then obviously all will take the same branch. Or you can also use wavefront-wide instructions. Those are the only two I will show you here. There are other wavefront-wide instructions, but here for this example, only those two are relevant. So we have wave active any true. So this returns true if any thread returns true. So if one thread returns true, doesn't matter what the other threads returned, they all will go, they all will have true. And wave active all true is basically only if all threads return true, then it's true. Yeah. So what to conclude from this topic? Well, first, again, kind of try to avoid to use too many VGPRs, because you are limited on the number of available VGPRs. And if you use too many per thread, you reduce the maximum number of wavefronts you can have concurrently fired per SIMD. And this, again, reduces the ability to hide latency. And then try to avoid diversion control flow within a wavefront, because if you have diversion control flow, you need to execute both blocks of the branch and not just one. And to do this, you should prefer using scalar comparisons, or in specific cases, you can also make use of wavefront-wide instructions. So, but now let's look at a specific example, just that you understand how this actually can be used to write compute shader kind of efficiently to solve problems. So downsampling itself is not a complicated problem, right? So it's just reducing your texture. So if you have a texture of size, for example, 4096 times 4096, you want to reduce it to 1 pixel. So this would also cover the problem if you have 4K textures and want to downsample them. For our specific problem, I chose the reduction factor 2 times 2 to 1 to 1. And I also want to store each intermediate level. So we kind of want to compute the MIP levels of this texture. So at the end, I want to have my original source texture and then all the intermediate levels up to 1 pixel. So that's the problem. Well, this problem, obviously, you also can solve it with a pixel shader, right? So with a pixel shader, you actually bind each intermediate level, so this one, as a render target. So the first pass would be the original source texture is the input texture, and then the render target is this texture, and then you make a second pass with this one as input texture, and this texture as output texture, and so on. So this is a capture using RGP. It's one of our tools. You can profile, you see what's happening on the GPU. So you see the number of wavefronts are currently in flight. And you see here there's a lot of going on. So this is the first pass when we actually compute the texture with dimension 2048 times 2048. So you see there's much going on. It takes quite a while. And then the first pass is done. So the GPU waits to be sure that really all threads are done so that the texture is really like finished, so computed. And then it's used as input for the second pass, which computes the next texture and so on. So what can we observe here in this pixel shader solution? Well, first, we're losing a lot of time just for waiting that all the threads are done with the work before we can start the second part, the next pass, right? So we have those gaps in which the GPU is not doing anything, basically. And then we also observe that computing the lower MIPS, there's not really much going on in GPU. We just have a few threads in flight. They're just computing a bit of a few pixels. I mean, if you have just 8 times 8, down to 4 times 4, and then to 2 times 2, I mean, just a few pixels, right? So most of the time, the GPU is just waiting that the few threads are done computing their stuff. And yeah, that's all. So you waste a lot of resources in just waiting for a few threads to complete their work. And this does not sound that performant, right? So what can you do better? Well, if you use pixel shaders, not really, because in a pixel shader, you can just access the respective pixel in the render target. So you don't have access to the complete output of the pass. And this also means that you can't combine the computation of several levels in one pass. But this is not true for compute shaders. In compute shaders, the output is provided via resources, right? So, and resources, you can actually access each entry of the texture you have bound. So what you can do is you can just bound all output levels as USVs directly in your shader, and then you can compute all levels in one pass. And if you do this and take, again, in a capture with using RGP, it looks something like this. So you see you don't have those gaps where you wait when one texture is done. And you have kind of like constant occupancy over most of the time. And if you measure the performance, you actually gain 100% performance improvement here. So but how did I actually code this compute shader? So what is the strategy behind this? So well, remember, we kind of want to avoid cross-compute unit communication. So that's why we try to let each thread group operate as much as possible independently. So we assign to each thread group a subsquare of the whole texture. And then we let it downsample it as much as possible. So if we chose the size to be a 64 times 64, we assign it to the thread group, and the thread group downsamples the 64 times 64 subsquare to one pixel. And then you can choose whatever size you want for the thread group, for example, 64 threads. So that one thread group has 64 threads, and it gets assigned a subsquare if size 64 times 64, and it's downsamples to one. So to make it a bit clearer, so each thread group gets a subsquare of size 64 times 64. This is a subsquare of this original source texture. And then it downsamples it to 32 times 32, which is a subsquare of this texture, and then again to 16, which is a subsquare of this one, and so on until 1. And this 1 is a sub, well, it's a pixel of this square, basically. And then we have this as an intermediate result, right? So 64 times 64 square. And now the question is, how do we downsample this last piece of texture? Well, if we want to downsample this, we need to be sure that all thread groups have completed their work. So this requires thread group communication. I know it's bad, but it's just one global atomic counter, so it's kind of kept really to a minimum, but we can't avoid it here because we need to be sure that this intermediate texture is completed and is computed completely. So with a global atomic counter, we track that each thread group is done, and then the last active thread group will do another round and downsamples this last piece of texture to one pixel. Another thing which needs to be done here is that this intermediate texture consists of pixels which are computed by different thread groups. So this means that this last active thread group needs to be able to see the changes the other thread groups made. And in order to see the source changes, they need to appear at least in L2, right? They can't stuck in L1 because L1 is on the compute unit, and we probably have many compute units which are having this information, and we just can't get it stuck there, so it needs to be visible in L2. This is why you need to bind it as coherent, but just this is just true for this specific level, which is kind of like this intermediate one. So, and if you look back at this capture, you see like this tiny end, well, this is the last active thread group actually computing the last maps. It's not that ideal, but, well, it's just, it went down to 1/3 of the whole, like, pass from a pixel shader down to just like 10 or 5% of the whole thing. So the complete picture, just to wrap it up, each thread group performs downsampling on its own 64 times 64 subpatch to 1, and then the last thread group does another round. So the total number of thread groups you invoke depends on the initial texture size. So in case of 4096 times 4096, we have actually a total 4096 threads. And the dispatch call would be 64 times 64. And of course, you can have different configurations. So you can vary the reduction factor. Of course, the texture format can be different. So you can have 4 channels, just 1 channel if you have a dev texture, and so on. And you can also vary the thread group size, which should be ideally a multiple of 64. And actually, this capture was taken with a thread group size of 256. It just resulted in better cache utility. So L1 cache could be used more efficiently than having a thread group size of, for example, only 64. But this really depends on the specific case. So this case was 4 channel texture, 4K. And for this case, it turned out 256 is better. But if you have a different case, maybe a thread group size of 64 turns out to be better. So the takeaway point here is that you should always measure your configuration and try out what works best for you. So, but with compute, you can, of course, also do other fun stuff. So you can solve various tasks using compute. For example, you can cull geometry on the GPU, you can do particle simulations, tile lighting, terrain calculations, tessellation, and many, many post-processing effects. On Vulkan, you even can present on the compute queue. So what you can do is you can move the complete post-processing stuff on the compute queue. And while you start doing the post-processing stuff, you can already start the next frame on the graphics queue using async compute. What's async compute? Well, it's async compute can be used to overlap compute-intensive work with graphics-intensive work. So one, you have the graphics queue, like your default queue, and on the same time, you also have your async compute queue, which is doing compute shader work. And a typical example where it really pays off really well is overlapping SSAO with shadow map calculation, because SSAO is really compute-intensive work, and shadow map calculation makes use of the graphics unit on the graphics card. So those would be the units I showed you in the beginning, which were then grayed out when we looked at the compute shaders. Yeah, so that's the last slide. Just short summary again. So compute shaders offer nice properties. So the output can be accessed from all threads. But we just saw it out our downsampling example. You have less hardware overhead because we don't need the graphics processor. We don't need the rasterizer. You can explicitly use local data share for inter-thread communication within a single thread group. And you also have access to wavefront-wide instructions. But of course, if you code for compute shaders, you also need to be aware of some coding guidelines to be sure that computers are actually efficient. So you should keep cross-thread group communication to a minimum. Don't use too many VGPRs. So if you don't need to use them, don't. If you need to, of course, you have to. And try to avoid diversion control flow. Yeah, but that's it. Now I give the stage to you. If you have any questions, you can ask now. And yeah, thanks.
Hello. I actually got a couple. So first of all, I think when you were comparing your compute, MIPMAP chain generation with compute versus pixel shader, I'm not really sure how you got like the full utilization, because I think like, correct me if I'm wrong, but anything after you compute like the first MIP level, not all of your threads in your thread group would be doing the job. So the lower you go, the more threads would be idling per each thread group. Is that true, or am I missing this?
That's true. So let's go back right here. So if you compute, if you downsample 64 times 64 to 32 times 32, obviously you need all the threads within your thread group, right? And then maybe if you downsample it to 16 times 16 again. But if you go into the lower levels, you don't need all of them anymore. But that's okay, to be honest. Because those levels, it's just a few pixels, and it doesn't take much time anyway. So if you have just a few idle threads here which are deactivated using the execution mark, it doesn't really, it doesn't, like, it's not bad in this case. Important is that those two first levels are computed really fast. You also see that if you actually look here, you see computing the first two levels take the most of the time. Alone, those two levels just take half. So getting this fast and speed up is the most important thing. So if you just have a few inactive thread for a few microseconds, it's not a problem.
And can you show like the final number? Because right now I have a feeling that you're basically saving just this like sync time between the draw calls, aren't you? Because I'm not sure how you actually optimizing within each like MIP level generation.
So you're right. So first I save here the gaps. That's what you meant, right?
Yeah.
But I also save here, because here, where you see, you have first all those huge gaps again, and then you just have a few threads in flight. Mm-hmm. So, but here, the thing is, you have one thread group, right? So you invoke it, and it's done, and here you just have like a few inactive threads. But then it's done, and once the subsquare is done, you can just invoke the next thread group, which is doing the next subsquare. And you don't need to wait until all the other thread groups are also done. So you can like schedule more work faster.
OK. And I have another follow-up question. We can utilize UAVs on pixel shaders, and we can utilize synchronization, like interlocked operations on pixel shaders. So how exactly in this case are we leveraging from compute? Because I believe we can pretty much like just instead of like a thread utilize like a one pixel shader and output using UAVs to multiple. Pixels. So, what would be what's the benefit of using compute? Because like the downside would be if we, for instance, want to use this exact texture right away, we would need to have like a compute to graphics synchronization.
Yeah, of course. I mean, it always depends on your use case. I mean, sometimes it might be more like more efficient to use pixel shader, of course, but here. First, you have more, like, I mean, it also depends on the reduction factor. So you also could use local data share. I didn't use it in this example because I just access each pixel one time. But if you have a different reduction factor, for example, phi times 3, and you have, like, overlapping, so this could be a use case here. So it always depends on your specific problem you want to solve, basically. I can't present you, like, one solution which works for a few problem cases.
Okay,
basically.
Thank you.
I mean, we can, if you have further questions, you can also come after the talk.
More questions?
Yeah, in the front.
Oh.
Hey, thanks for the talk. I was just wondering about getting the data into the compute shader from the CPU side and then getting it back again if you wanted to do that sort of thing. Is there a way to kind of synchronize so you know this data has been processed and now I can access it on the CPU side? Can you do that sort of thing?
So you are talking basically about different memory types and, well, it really depends what you're using the data for. So if it's, I mean, if you just store it and like on the CPU, and then you kind of need to transfer it, like using the copy queue, for example, on the GPU, and it kind of takes a while. And there's also other, like for AMD, for example, you have a specific type of memory which is can also be seen by the CPU. It's called, I think, it's kind of like special memory type. I need to look it up. I can tell you later. And it depends really for what you want to use the memory type. So.
And do you, can you get like a callback when it's when the process is finished? Is there that sort of concept?
What do you mean exactly? Sorry.
So you get on the CPU side, you get told, hey, we're done now. You can read the data.
So if the GPU is done with its work, to tell the CPU, well, you need to have like synchronization point for that. Yeah. And then make like a copy back to the CPU to make it visible to the CPU. Yeah. Cool.